Carl, studio in car. This is the Dynaudio C2. So as the story goes, every now and again we'll have a product that we either trade in or something that sits around for a while, gets a bit mucky in here even though it doesn't really get used that much, something that doesn't sell for a long period of time, and we'll offload it or offer it up for some form of swap. And this came back. So set of C2s, swapped for another set of floor standards that were around the place. Set them down to listen to them the day after, and immediately heard that one of the tweeters was just down. It wasn't playing all the way up. Sounds like it's playing to sort of 3 or 4K, something like that. It's kind of stuck there, can't get it. You know, give it a little bit of volume, see if anything changes, change left to right speaker and everything like that. Now, the gentleman that we swapped them with, Nathan's a lovely guy. I've met him a couple of times now. You know, I've no reason to believe that he knew what was up. It seems like it's a genuine thing where either we've moved them from there to here, or when we've brought them upstairs or something like that. So I was just gonna take them apart, figure them out, see what part we need to replace. And Stuart suggested that we may as well shoot this, because it's easy to get complacent in a place like this where we'll just pull these things apart and put them back together because it's relatively standard practice for us. And he's actually, you know, he's right. It will make some good footage, and it will show that, you know, we're not really shy of taking drive units apart, figuring out what's wrong, where it is on the signal chain that there's an issue. I'm not too sure if we're talking tweeter or crossover at the moment. Usually a dead tweeter would be completely dead, but these work in a particularly strange way. This is Dynaudio directivity control tweeter, so the top tweeter has its bandwidth restricted by filtering, and the bottom tweeter plays all the way up. So I think we've got an issue with the bottom tweeter. We may have an issue with the crossover, or we may have an issue with the tweeter, I'm not too sure. I'm going to show you the steps that we take, taking it apart. And first I'm going to lay it down flat so it stops making me look as short as I am. Back with you in a second. First things first, lay them down. I'm going to get the drive units out of them.
Chimba se ha formado la corredera, en el barrio la cachimba se ha formado la corredera, allá fueron los bomberos con sus campanas, sus sirenas, allí fueron los bomberos con sus campanas, sus sirenas, ay mamá, ¿qué pasó? Ay mamá, ¿qué pasó?
So, for you guys, it's been a split second. For me, it's been 3 days. I've got time lapse of me taking this apart, but I had to stop because I had to deal with something, and then the next day was very busy, and then the Confidence 20s turned up, so that's kind of, you know, split me aside, but this is still in the same position it was when I had to leave the video. So, what I've done, I've taken the drivers out, and you have to take the drivers out to release the tweeter unit, the fascia, or the baffle for the tweeters. This is trapped, it's like an interruption fit, so the bolts for the mid-basses clamp this down with a gasket that passes in front and behind to keep, the cabinet sealed. So, at least sealed from the front, because there's a whopping port on the back. Now, So, the issue, we know that we have got limited response from the bottom tweeter. The bottom tweeter is the one that plays full, you know, all the way up. The top one plays limited bandwidth. 2 seconds. Excuse me, that was Peachtree pre-DAC and GAN 400's just turned up, so that's exciting stuff. So we know we have limited bandwidth from one of the tweeters, so now I've stripped apart, I've had a look at the crossovers. Visually they look fine, they never really do look, even when they are damaged, they never really do look damaged unless something's got really hot. These are soldered kind of point to point, so I do have to do some cutting or unsoldering to you remove the things that I need to remove, which is why the baffle is still just sat on the fascia of the speaker. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to remove this unit. I'm not going to remove the tweeters. I'm going to keep it as one thing so that I can test the bottom one and test the top one, things like that. There's no physical difference between the sitar tweeters. It's the crossover that governs the bandwidth that each one plays. So I'm going to put a sort of full range signal via a high pass into each one, so I can see if the tweeters are working. Now, if they are playing, their full response, both of them, then we have a filtering problem. So we have a crossover problem, basically. From then, I'll decide what I want to do, whether I want to replace the crossovers or whether I have an abundance of time, which probably isn't going to happen. And I will, in that case, if I were to do that, I would probably test point to point on all of the crossover components and then replace, which would be, for someone with a lot of time, would be far and away the cheapest way to repair something like this. But we don't have an awful lot of time, or should I say, there's things I would prefer to be doing with my time. So, I'm gonna set about this and I will be back in a minute and I will let you know whether these are working properly. If they are, like I say, then we need to start looking at the crossovers. If they aren't, then I need to whip a set out of the other ones. I'm gonna put these in that one just to double check and then we'll be away, all right? Give me a minute. Taken out, and I've used my my homemade three-way crossover for my NS1000s. I just wanted a signal that I can rely on its output level and frequency, so that I can check this one versus the other one and see what's going on. Now, I think we've got a bit of a double thing going on here, because the frequency-wise, bandwidth-wise, they're playing full range, they're playing the range that they should, they're playing all the way up, which is kind of what I expected, but they're around 4 point something dB down on the other side, over the other side, so these are lower, they're playing lower, which means we've got a driver issue. The bandwidth issue, and the thing that brought my attention to it, was that it wasn't playing the sort of frequencies it should be playing, which would represent itself in a very dull speaker, and did. Whereas just the levels being down, the speaker would still be lively. It's just your stage would skew to whichever direction the speaker that was working normally would be. The one down would kind of, it would be getting carried by the other speaker. So, yeah, what I'm going to do is I will I'll make this a part one, because it's you know, to keep this speaker apart is kind of unfair on the speaker and the environment. So the environment that we're in. So I'm going to put it back together now, not connect it. I'm going to speak to those guys about tweeters, and I'm going to speak to them about crossovers. Now, I've already spoken to them actually in terms of availability. So they carry over 40 years worth of sort of you know, repair stock. So things from older speakers, say the you know, one of my personal favorites, the Contour, the 1.2 SE, like the really nice stand mount, the Bird's Eye sort of stand mount speaker, Bird's Eye Maple. And yeah, so you know, the parts are there, they're in stock. I just wanted to determine what it was. So I'm probably going to speak to them about ordering a set of the high pass crossovers, so the tweeter crossovers in here, which are quite a small part, and a set of tweeters as well. Now, of course, I'm going to it'll have to be a pair of each. I won't replace one without replacing the other. You know, we don't want that. We don't want to be running one speaker in, and it'll just, in my mind, it doesn't work like that. You know, I'd rather they just be a matched pair from a batch, and the crossover's the same. So I'll speak to them about that, and I'll see how that goes. And I'll likely put that in part two of the video, where I put it back together, and we can test the speakers and see how everything goes. But you know, they're a great company to deal with, so I imagine I'll get a great response from them in terms of, you know, looking after me or a client that say had a similar issue, I imagine. So yeah, let's have a chat with them. But yeah, my findings are we're a few dB down on these compared to the other tweeters, and we have a bandwidth issue. So crossovers and tweeters, let's see how we get on with Dynaudio, and let's see how we get on repairing the speaker, because from what I did hear, they're a magnificent speaker. My findings with this, like I say, I have no experience with the C2, so I found that the tweeter crossover is directly wired to the it's soldered to a ferrule, and the ferrule is clamped in place on the back of, if you're not familiar with ferrules, it's like a little chimney-shaped object that goes over the end of a wire, and then it's crimped in. In this case, it's soldered. It's a solid ferrule that's soldered on, and then it's clamped into the back of the binding post. Now, that cable goes directly from the binding post to the high-pass filter crossover, and then out to the tweeters, one with slightly different circuitry to the other, because, of course, one plays about, I think, 3 to 8K. The other one plays 3 all the way up. So it's not like there's another crossover there. It's not a three-way design. The crossover for the mid-bass is in the plinth, is in the bass. So you take that off. It's got some real long Allen screws. And I needed to take that off because I wanted to see if the high-pass part of the crossover was wired in any way through the sort of bass part of the crossover, just how it picked it up, how it came to the tweeters. So I took that all off. Forgot to get a video of it, so you know, if I get some time, I'll probably strip that down again. There's no need in this video, because this is about the tweeters rather than about stripping down the whole speaker. But yeah, so that part is actually in the plinth of the cabinet. So I took that off, and sure, that's where I found that that crossover is wired directly to the post. So I didn't really need to do it. Now, of course, a continuity test between the two wouldn't tell me whether it was wired through the crossover or not. It would just tell me that we have continuity there and to the binder post, which of course we should. If we had no tweeter at all, you could possibly find no continuity between the two, depending on the problem. But yes, we've got a little bit of a bandwidth problem, crossovers, a little bit of an amplitude or an output problem, drivers. So let's see how we get on. Very well made speaker, gorgeous thing, and I'm looking forward to having it fixed up. I'm going to put it back together so that it doesn't look ugly in this place, and so that none of its bits get lost or used in a car somewhere. All right, let's put it back together. Whilst I'm putting this back together, I might ramble on a little bit about how it comes apart and how it was, how I found taking it apart, which I was a little surprised that the tweeter sort of array or the tweeter baffle was sandwiched. You know, of course, their machining means it's sandwiched solid, but it was just a little surprise for me. I didn't expect that to be the case. I expected to find a flange like so underneath with its own bolts. Now, of course, if you were to do that, one newton meter of over tightening and you would create a lip, a step on the face. So the fact these two are machined like that with a certain amount of measurement going on here means that they'll always be linear if it is this that bolts through there, in terms of the way that it mounts. So it's clever, and you know, it effectively is a floating design between two baffles, which is, you know, great for decoupling it from the face of the speaker, really. Just try, got to try and keep this gasket in line. No point in it being there if it's all squashed up. Pretty sure that's in there properly now. And then, yeah, that kind of, it looks like you should be doing more to that to fix that in, but that's kind of the way it works. And then you have this gasket area. Now, I'll scooch back to another bit of the video now where you can see how thick this faceplate is. This looks to me to be about 20, no, it's probably 30 mil thick, this. Then plus a glass sheet, which is behind it. And then plus the face of the enclosure, which is another 18 mil. So we've got over 50 mil here of front baffle. This is so sort of dead and strong front to back. I was surprised that when I stripped the crossover out, I noticed that the box, the end of the ceiling of the box is there. So the speaker could actually be a foot shorter. Not that you'd really want it to be. It's quite cool that it's quite an imposing looking thing. But yeah, so that was one of my findings with that. What else did I discover that I wasn't expecting to discover inside? This foam stuff gets a little bit rigid over time, I suppose, but it's still perfectly manageable. I think someone may have opened these up before, because there's this wadding sort of fluff. It's just on there. There's none actually in there. It's just on the foam. So my inexperience with stripping these down, you know, I would imagine somebody at some point has already had them apart. Whether they've modified something and whether that makes this issue, you know, that's the standout issue. It certainly doesn't look like anything's been modified to me. It looks like an original crossover board. The cabling, all the soldering of the cables is all the same. You know, it was all quite uniformly done, so I'm not too sure. But this isn't how this goes in here. This is just me jamming this back in so that I can get the speaker to be one at one again. On the other one of these, I've got a cracked panel. Now, these glass panels are there as a decorative thing. I'm not a huge fan, but they are there, and I will replace that. Now, when I saw them, when they come in, because of the fabrication and the design work that we do when we're building sort of show display stuff for car audio, I understood immediately how they were on there. Someone had tried to pry it off, to get it off, and it cracked. I don't know that for a fact, but I would put money on that's what's happened. Someone's tried to get them off. The first one they've tried to get off is smashed. It's very obvious to me that in a design like this, there would be a threaded bar in the back of these units, and that there would be a nut inside here, which I can show you because I'll have some footage of that somewhere. These nuts will undo, and they will just effectively slide off. You shouldn't do it, of course, because you're going to create an air hole. So I will put mine, you know, I will take mine off and I will replace it with a new one, which is still available from Dynaudio. Now, every part is the whole fascia plate, the tweeters, the mid bass unit, the lot, they're all there and they're all in stock. So fantastic to, you know, company to deal with. Yeah, and I'll include, you know, what it costs me and things like that to get them, you know, to get the parts done, because these are, they're expensive speakers, you know, they're not, they're a, pretty sure they're a £12,000 speaker, so you could never expect the parts to be cheap to repair them, but, you know, we can at least look and I can let you know what that's going to cost and potentially what it would cost someone else with damaged C2s. This isn't something I'm expecting to ever do for anyone. This is something that, you know, you probably would just do yourself, but it's always worth knowing the potential costs. You'll be in for a treat in a minute as well, because you'll get to see my one finger Allen key, which wasn't really a thing to me until someone else pointed it out one day. Yeah, so this, you know, I'm by no means an engineer or someone that does this kind of thing all day every day. My test equipment is quite, we have some great test equipment, but I'm not going to wheel it out to test if a tweeter is playing it's correct bandwidth. It's very easy to determine that sort of stuff, but it's more of a sort of, what I think what gives me the confidence to do stuff like this is in our car audio business, we constantly deal with raw drivers. It's all we deal with, and we're constantly messing with digital crossovers. We're constantly messing with signal paths, testing signal paths, and you know, getting stuff done in that way. So this to me is a very simple thing to determine what is wrong. The fact that there's two issues is possibly what's thrown me or taken me, you know, slightly longer to figure out, because usually you would be able to tell, or I would be able to tell immediately what was wrong. Not that there is something wrong, but what was wrong. I couldn't, because I was a little baffled, no pun intended, that the speaker was still playing, but it sounded bandwidth restricted, which was very obvious, and to me I would almost entirely expect that to be a crossover issue, some form of resistor, some form of capacitor, whichever. I like I say, don't give me stick about my terminology, because this isn't something I do or have learned or studied. It's just something that I kind of know how to do. But that's it. While we're hopefully our one finger Allen keyed all of those in. you know, that's it. They're kind of back together now, because I don't want them to be a mess in the shop. And what we'll do is we'll speak to them. I'll include you guys in that. I'll let you know what comes of it. And part two will hopefully be some shiny bits, some putting them back together. And then, unfortunately, we don't really get to listen to them for the first time, because we're going to have to put them through some stick for a number of hours, and we'll have then a realistic view of what they sound like. You know, might just get a whole slew of new drivers. I don't know. We'll see. All right, guys. I'm Carl. This is Studio In Car, and this is me fixing a C2, Dynaudio C2. Take it easy, have a good weekend, and happy listening, all right? Ay, mama.